BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency. Your Berks Craftsmen on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival and by the Reading-Berks Guild of Craftsmen.
Good evening and welcome to tonight's edition of Your Berks Craftsmen. I am Kay Bennecoff, your host, and you are in for a real treat tonight. We have with us several artists, the show chairperson, the president of the Reading-Berks Guild of Craftsmen, all here to talk about our 72nd Holiday Fine Art and Craft Festival that is coming up on Saturday, October 29th from 9 to 5, and on Sunday, October 30th from 10 to 4. And like I said, this is an action-packed show tonight with all these wonderful craftsmen and fine artists here tonight. And Steve, our show chairperson, is right here.
Yes, Kay, I'm here, and I'm happy to be here and talk about our show. It's going to be a great show. We have a large number of jewelry craftsmen. Our guild jewelry is a craftsman, as you know, so we have quality stuff. Not everyone is in our guild, but they've all been juried by the guild process.
Oh, right. And they're from the Pennsylvania Guild of Craftsmen.
And they're all members of the Pennsylvania Guild of Craftsmen, and our chapter, the Reading-Berks chapter, is
a chapter of.
Mm-hmm. And so we hold two shows, as you know. We held this one on the 29th, and we hold one in the spring week before Mother's Day.
Yeah, it's the first Saturday.
First Saturday,
So it's not always the week before
Mother's Day. It's the first Saturday.
We're just calling it that first Saturday in May. So hopefully in 2023, we're not going to have the rain and the wind and all that stuff that we used to have.
But you're we're so not negative. It's fine.
I said we're not talking about it.
It was a pretty good show, but we're trying to get sell Boosa there. So, it is all covered, so if it's a problem, it's not a problem out there.
Okay. Well, right, at the one coming up here on the 29th and 30th, what a wonderful venue.
That's covered because that's inside the Fieldhouse.
Tell
that's
them
the
about
opaque
that.
Fieldhouse.
How beautiful
it is. At Kutztown University, which is right across from the Student Center. There's ample parking, there's handicap parking, and it's a real nice venue. So we're going to have a lot of vendors in there and quality craftsmen with demonstrations. We have continuous live music and it's a place to buy nice food and a snack or lunch or a cup of coffee or donut or whatever your fancy is. Hopefully you'll like to buy some quality crafts too.
Yeah, and you just find everything there. I mean,
it runs the gamut because there's some very traditional craftspersons and there's some more slightly contemporary craftspeople. I guess I would be more contemporary, but I'm a I'm a potter, but my pottery is contemporary, but thrown traditionally.
Well, I think stoneware has a long history of
I just make what I like, and that's...
There you go.
People can classify it, but our craftsmen are very varied. I mean...
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, several of our craftsmen, traditionally speaking, they have been... chosen for the early American life, which is mostly traditional.
There's a large number in early American life, and there's also a lot of guild jewelry from the state
too,
as well as our
Pennsylvania
craftsmen. So that really gives us a lot of cachet with that.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So. And like you said, they're all jewelried by peers, other craftsmen, and everything. So
our jewelry people are people that are used to looking work. There's several former art teachers on there, as well as, and in addition, they are craftsmen also, but you know, there's also a variety of people that look at the drawing process. And, you know, we pick it up and look over it. I was on the drawing team for quite a while, and you really, your stuff really gets scrutinized quite well, and you'll get some tips back at the end.
Yeah.
And, but it's also helped to help the artists come along and feel comfortable with the group, and you become a peer then, obviously.
Yeah, yeah. We also have a student gallery at
this
show.
Yes, we have a student gallery.
And that is to, of course, promote young and old, you know, just, we call them emerging artists, right? You know, I mean, you know, so it doesn't matter if they're 15 or if they're 50 and just starting out in the arts and crafts world.
Yeah, and it's been very varied over the years.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, there's been some wood carvers and some potters and some jewelers and some people doing eclectic things and stitchery. It's been very, I find it fascinating. So it's always a nice component of that. And we have somewhere between just a couple to 15 or 18 or so.
Yeah, so it does
depending
vary.
On the year.
We do try to, you know, encourage them to do that. So Carol Hiley, our education chairperson, does a good job in trying to get that out there so that our the students find out, you know, it's open to Albright, Alvernia, Kutztown.
And high school students, too.
Yeah, because we do the BCIU, the Berks County Intermediate Unit Art Show.
And that's at, where the, we, at the Goggle Works.
At the Goggle Works, yes. And the Goggle Works, because there's students there,
students,
you know.
A
and
lot we, of the students
and
there.
And we invite them as well. So, yeah, so there's a lot of chances for all you emerging artists.
And, and there's prize money. All the craftsmen vote on their favorites, and that student will win a...
Win a monetary prize.
Yeah, so, and plus they get to sell their wares for no fee.
Yes, so, because we provide all the backdrops and everything.
Yeah, we provide.
And a lot of times, many of our craftsmen who, especially the ones who've been doing the show for a while, you know, they become a mentor to that, you know, to the craftsmen and to the young craftsmen and artists. And so we enjoy doing that as well.
We do.
Okay.
We do.
Well, you know, we have several of our craftsmen and artists here.
Who are we going to quiz first? Who are we going to put in the griddle first?
Well, let's just start with that old guy down on the end there who happens to be the president of the Reading-Berks Guild of Craftsmen.
He gets here a lot, but he often gets cut out. So
yes,
let's give him top billing. So
we'll give him top billing.
Barry
tonight,
will do a nice job.
So he filled
with that.
In. Hi, honey. He happens to be my husband, too. So. Barry, why don't you tell us what you do? And
I make country furniture, and I've also been running this small circus of Guild of Craftsmen for the last 16 years.
He's our fearless leader.
But yeah, I make the country furniture. This one's been very popular this year. This we call this cookbook nook, and cookbooks on the top and the drawers. You could. The large recipe cards fit in drawers that we have on the other part. And Kay came up with this pumpkin-y finish on this thing. I think it's going to be a good one for this fall. So that's going to be interesting. But we do lots of different pieces and a lot of custom work right now. That's a big thing that we're really working on. But got to get a few new pieces out for every show and all that. And then we have the candle stand, and I forgot to put the candle thing on top. It's in one of the drawers here, but I forgot about it. But that's got all the drawers, and the drawers are all half-blind dovetailed on this and on that piece. So it's a very unique piece, and nice conversation piece for in a small space.
Now, what are both of those made out of?
They're both made out of Eastern White Pine. I buy local sawmills.
Or?
That's normally what I use, but I have branched out, did some pieces in walnut, some in oak, cherry, and I just finished a real big pantry that was made out of birch.
And I've seen something you made out of a wormy chestnut, which is extinct, so that's kind of fun to recycle lumber, I suppose.
Well, that, I do some things with cedar. You know, so I've branched out over the years and gotten into all kind of different things. So come and ask me for something special, and I just sort of have a hard time turning them down.
Excellent.
Yeah, we like designing, you know, with the people in mind, yes. Right? You know, so we do that a lot.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
thank you.
Thanks for filling in here tonight, Barry, too.
It's one of those things. I actually hosted the show 3 times at one point.
Yeah, he does whatever he needs to do.
He's a very good president. Irreplaceable.
Well, we're all replaceable, but we are grateful for all your hard work over the years.
Well, it does bring up, if you have a craft, you could consider joining us.
Yes.
At our meetings at the Goggle Works.
Yes.
And
yes.
We're always looking for craftsmen, different craftsmen. And
artists.
Yeah, you don't have to be the world's greatest craftsman, but we have to be serious about your work.
And, yeah. Well, and that's the one thing, you know, that we said, you know, you come out to we meet on the first Tuesday of the month at the Goggle Works.
Right.
Okay, it's always up on the blackboard there when you come in. And the good thing about coming to our meetings is that you will meet a craftsman who does the, you know, who works in wood or works in jewelry, works, you know, in art, and they want to help you. They want to share with you, you know,
yep.
And you learn. That is such a valuable, you know, component to just joining our guild, you know.
Including things as the salesmanship and how to set a booth up what do you need?
Yeah.
So if you're interested in getting involved with that, then that's something you should probably consider coming out and talking with us and becoming a member.
Yeah, go ahead, Barry.
There's one thing I'd like to add with the whole fine art thing and all that we've gotten into. I mean, we used to be that we would just invite fine artists to our shows, and then we got to the point where we really pushed for it and we started juring fine art also.
Yes.
Because it's a craft. I mean, it takes a lot of talent to do a lot of that flat work that gets done. Mm-hmm. So it's hard to determine with some flat works and painting what is really a craft and what is.
Yeah, and as we got, as our guild grew, we found the need to do that more and more because, you know, I mean, the fine artists and are such a integral part of our guild now, you know, and everything. I mean, it's, you know, it truly is, you know, and so.
Well, we're always looking for new ideas. Not that fine art's new, but,
But that's the thing about whatever was old is new again, and then it just keep building and building on that.
Even all the traditional stuff was once contemporary.
That's what I always say, yes.
It's true.
You know, so. But, I mean, as you go on and you go to all these shows, you know, and stuff, you just keep seeing new things and what people are doing with. Like, I keep getting more and more impressed with all the things that are showing up as metal.
Oh, yeah. Well, we have more metal artists right now.
We do. I mean,
and not just jewelry, just like.
No. I mean,
chunks of metal. Yeah. welded things. And
yeah.
Very. You need to come out and see it. It's pretty neat.
Yeah. Yeah. We have several metal. I'm calling them metal workers, okay? You know, and we've juried them, you know, in the most recent last few years. So.
Well, I guess it's almost all welded or brazed somewhere.
It's
a lot of cool stuff.
It is cool stuff. You're right.
I could get rid of a lot of junk if I would weld. And sell it.
Yard art.
Yeah, you know, and then turn it into some really cool stuff, you know, which is out there. So, yeah, come to the show. You'll find it. So, okay. Well, who should we pick on?
We should probably just go down the row.
Just go down the row.
Why not?
Okay. Okay.
It
must be Diane.
Diane has some stuff to tell us
and
about.
And she has some.
I just know how to weld too.
I will say that I was at the last meeting when the people that were recently juried in. And I've known Diane, I guess, for about 8 or 10 years from shows and stuff. And
Kutztown.
I was just fascinated. Just the amount of stuff that she does and.
Oh, thank you.
And the complexity of her work. And I just really thought of her as like a painting, drawing person. But no, she has more facets. Please tell us about yourself.
I started out with traditional watercolors. And I did mostly all painting. And then I divulged into doing a lot with ink. And then I started doing some with acrylic. And this is one of my originals down here. So you can see all the detail that I put into a painting. They take me anywhere from, I'd say, a couple of weeks to several months to paint. And when I do paint, I layer a lot. So a lot of my paints are layered. And so they glaze. So you start out with a very pale red, and then I build up the color, let it dry. One good thing about watercolors, they dry fast.
Okay.
I used to do oils, and you'd have to wait forever for the oil to dry. So
sure.
I stopped doing oils completely, but I'll fool around with everything else, you know, from acrylic, glitter. I've even gotten some glitter lately that I've been doing. And one of my fun things that I showed at the meeting was the fabric.
Can I interrupt you a minute?
Yeah.
Could you explain how you always have a quilt in your...
Yes. Well, I used to do paintings at the art shows, and I did, always looking for my niche, my little niche that I could paint. And I did flowers, I did animals, I did scenery, and one day I just put a quilt in a painting. And it was all because I saw a quilt at a country store. So I put it in the painting, and so many people said they liked that one so much. So then I thought, well, I'll do a Christmas one. And that was my second one, was the Christmas one. And then people were asking if I was going to do a fall one, if I was going to do seasons. And so that's what I started doing. I even have a Halloween one here, since our our show does happen to fall on Halloween weekend. So this was
Is it a Halloween quilt, or is it just a quilt with the pumpkins?
There's pumpkins, jack-o'-lanterns,
and then
there's
moon,
quilts. It was a huge painting, much too big to even bring here. And so I also did some Halloween fabric, special for our show, since we kind of are on the cusp of Halloween weekend. Do we have to dress up? Halloween weekend, and then we're going into the holidays.
Elaborate on the fabric a little bit so for the people that don't weren't at the meeting last week.
Well, I did start doing fabric with companies, and they would do it on big, huge bolts, and they would pay me a licensing fee. And so I do have some of that. And this I started doing on my own with a company called Spoonflower.
Okay.
And the nice thing about this fabric is it's printed in the United States. Almost every fabric out there is printed overseas. So this was nice because it's a digital print. So they don't have all the four color separations that they have, but they really get the color.
The color's vibrant.
And this was this is the one you can see the color from the original.
That's
down below.
Nice. Oh, yeah.
So you can see the how bright it is. This is the color.
And what would your patrons do with that piece of fabric?
They can do anything from making a quilt. I'm also designing borders to go with it. I'm pulling out different flower pieces, different things to go with it. That's in the process now. They can make tote bags. They can make home decor. Pillows are very popular. You can make a little pillow. And that's and especially the tote bags are very popular, too.
And probably even frame that and then do some quilting. I mean, you know, because you appeal so much to the quilting world. You know, I mean.
Here's this one again. So you can do that. You can do a framing. You can do it for Christmas. You can decorate it and put it above the fireplace or
But all
on
of
the
these
wall.
Started as painting. Everything was
painting.
A painting, you know.
Yes, and then I've also done it two different things, too. I've done tapestry. For my paintings, which I don't have anymore, not even, I didn't even get to keep any for myself. I've done puzzles, and the Kutztown Folk Festival this year, I sold every puzzle I had. And so right now, I don't have any new puzzles.
Cards?
And cards, I do have the note cards. And I sell these at the show, too, and show these. And I have Christmas cards, so all my winter scenes are available for Christmas cards.
Yeah, so. And you don't do a stitch of quilting with a needle and thread, right?
No,
your quilting is
I've
done
attempted
with the paintbrush.
To, and I think, as I said at our meeting, I did one for a company, and when it came back, they had redone it for me, so, because my stitches are not nearly what a quilter does.
Yes, very nice. Well, I can see how the. I mean, this just appeals to everyone. You know,
thank you.
You know, I mean, like you said, the colors are the way you build up the color, the intensity of the colors is very nice.
Thank you.
It's a beautiful, beautiful picture. Anyone would love to have it. So, yeah. How did you come into doing it?
With the painting?
Yeah.
I went for engineering, and I always wanted to be an artist, and I finally decided to just do my art full time. So I quit the engineering and the computers, and which I was struggling with the math, mm-hmm. artists aren't great with math, so I was struggling anyway, so I decided to go into the painting instead.
Mm-hmm. So you were artistic as a child?
Yes, I mean, yes, you always.
Know, you know. Yes. And then you went to engineering.
Yes.
The dark side.
Boring.
You make a living.
There you go. Well, I find it very intriguing, and I'm sure all our guests do, and our fellow artists, found it very good, too. So, very good. Thank you. Well, we'll come back to you, okay? So, should we go on to Bruce?
Let's go see what Bruce has to say.
Let's see what Bruce.
I just met Bruce tonight.
Yeah, he's joining us for the first time here in the studio. I mean, so he's been to our shows before, though.
You've done our shows before.
Mm-hmm. And you let me back in.
I know. Well, we have a new jury show. I don't know. We'll have to talk to them.
Yeah, Bruce Garrabrandt. Take it away.
I'm a colored pencil artist who began with no talent at all for art. None. Seriously. As a kid, I just had a passion to learn how to draw. Okay. And I've learned that if you have a passion for anything and you're willing to do it badly and don't quit, you're going to get better at it. But I never dreamed that I'd be earning my living doing it. So I am grateful because I have no practical skills. My wife will testify to that. When there's trouble with the plumbing or the wiring, I can draw you a picture of it until qualified help arrives. So in college, I majored in pre-unemployment. I was an English major.
Okay.
And when
everybody
I graduated,
already spoke English.
When I graduated, the only job I could find was in advertising, but my heart wasn't in it, so I decided the rest of me shouldn't be there either. And 37 years ago, I started my own business as a color pencil artist, pencil and color pencil, traditional landscapes and portraits. Okay. But I've always loved humor, and about a dozen years into it, I thought, I'm going to mix some whimsical pieces in with the traditional work. And then 4 days before, 4 days after 9/11, I was scheduled to do a show in Upper Montclair, New Jersey. I thought the show would be canceled because a lot of people who lived in Upper Montclair worked at the towers and died there. They had the show, and people did come out. The crowds were down, but people did mm-hmm. come out. And all weekend long, people came into my booth, and they looked at the whimsical pieces and then turned to say some variation of, thanks, that's the first time I've laughed in 4 days. It was humbling, and I sat there thinking, God gave us a sense of humor because he knew we were going to need one. And I decided that day that from then on, I would do just random acts of artistic nonsense. So for the past 21 years, that's what I've been doing. And I have some samples here. I live in Lancaster County, and I'm surrounded by four-legged models, cows primarily. This is light cream.
If you can zoom in on that, you have to tell us what it says. They're great.
This is light cream, yes. The comic possibilities with cows are endless. This is grilled chicken. I want you to know I only do these to watch my wife roll her eyes. She rolls them so much people think it's a medical condition. A lot of lab lovers out there. This is my lab technician, very studious. And about 15 years ago, I started to do a series of whimsical pieces that were spoofs on famous artists. And I tried to mimic their style. And what's fun with color pencil is it could be made to look like oil or pastel or watercolor. So the first in the series was Van Gogh. And I showed it to my wife when it was finished, and she rolled her eyes, so I knew I was on the right track. And I've done a whole series of these. I've also done coffee table books. All of my artwork and my coffee table books are available on my website, artbybruce.com. And for my latest coffee table book, I decided to do a self-portrait that reflected my serious intellectual nature. So this is herring impaired. People laugh, but it is a scholarly work.
And I'm sure.
I can prove it. Like all scholarly works, it contains an appendix. It's hard to believe that a post-middle-aged man can actually earn a living doing this sort of thing.
Well, when we chatted earlier before the show and you said that you did try stand-up comedy, I can't believe you weren't able to get that across.
I have a collection of spitballs. Would you like to see them?
You know, and now you are such a good example of people, you know, when people come into the show and they go, I just don't have an artistic bone in my body. You said that you couldn't draw.
Think back to when you were 5 years old. Mm-hmm. You were loaded with creativity then. Mm-hmm. Every five-year-old is. You never lose that. Mm-hmm. You just let it go dormant. Mm-hmm. But you can reawaken it. Mm-hmm. One of the books I wrote was called Make Yourself Ageless. It's 366 ways to keep growing young. When you're in midlife or beyond, you have decades of life experience you didn't have when you were five. If you were creative then, imagine how much more creative you could be now with mm-hmm. all that material to draw upon. But people undervalue themselves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. No, they should just come in. Do you do sessions like in your booth then, you know, like when
psychiatric
you're...
Psychiatric
sessions? Yeah.
I think I went to
maybe you get a free session. You can go.
I
went to a psychiatrist once, and he listened to me for an hour, and then he said, you know, Bruce, maybe life isn't for everybody. So, no, I don't do therapy.
But I think that your free advice, you know, and encouragement, you know, to anyone stopping in at your booth, you know, and that, and to encourage them into the art world and the creative part.
Oh, yeah,
you know,
absolutely.
I mean,
everyone is passionate about something.
Yeah.
The problem is people don't see that as their gift. They think they need the talent up front.
Uh-huh.
It's wonderful when that happens, but that's rare.
Mm-hmm.
You're supposed to commit to what you're passionate about. That's your calling.
Mm-hmm.
And nurture that and develop that into a talent mm-hmm. or an ability that you can use in ways that serve other people. Mm-hmm. I think our passions are our calling. Mm-hmm. And if we have about 2 minutes before this is over, I'll tell you my favorite story about passion.
Well, go ahead.
In the late 1930s...
We got time.
In the late 1930s, the federal government decided that Hollywood wasn't making enough pro-government films. As if that were any of FDR's business, but we won't go there. So pressure was applied, and Hollywood complied. In 1939, a film was released to the theaters called Code of the Secret Service. The producer and the director of that film hated it. The young star of the film hated it. And when the movie was released to the theaters that year, the year of Gone with the Wind, The Wizard of Oz, it bombed at the box office. The public didn't care for it. But there was a young boy from Montgomery, Alabama, named Jerry Parr, who saw that film and was intrigued by it. And so he saw it again. And 9-year-old Jerry Parr made up his mind that when he grew up, he was going to join the Secret Service. For him, it became a passion, and he held to it. And as a young man, he applied, and he was accepted into the Secret Service. And through the years, he rose through its ranks. He spent his entire career in the Secret Service. And it was Jerry Parr, in March of 1981, who leaped between a wounded Ronald Reagan and John Hinckley's gun, pushed Reagan into the car, and against the president's wishes, insisted that he be driven to the hospital. And by doing that, he literally saved the president's life. Oh, the star of that 1939 film, Ronald Reagan.
Wow.
You never know where your passion, your calling.
Halloween chills.
You never know where your calling is going to take you.
Yeah.
Commit to your passion. That's why you're here.
Yeah. Well, Bruce, you have certainly entertained us tonight with your books, but also with that story.
Yeah, it was a good story.
Yeah, that was a great story. Thank you for sharing. You know, so. Okay. Well, we'll come back to you too as well. And so now
you have to follow.
So
that,
now
Paula.
I know.
Yes.
I'll do my best.
Paula is our, she's new with us.
She's literally the newest member of the group.
She is our newest mm-hmm. member here. So and we are so happy to have her here tonight.
Oh, yes. Thank you for having me.
Well, you're very welcome. Mm-hmm. And she is a jewelry artist, craftsman.
Yep.
And take it away.
Okay, so I started doing enameling when I went to graduate school. I'm actually an art teacher. I teach middle school three-dimensional art. And when I went to graduate school, I had taken metals before, but when at Kutztown, and I went back and we did enameling, which we don't normally do in the regular classes, and I just fell in love with it. I love color. I do a lot of color pencil work as well, and I was just thinking, this is the way I can marry the two. I love working with metals, love working with color. So enameling is colored glass on metal. It's a lot of the traditional techniques go back to France or in Russia. Like, you see a lot of enameling work. A lot of people are familiar with the Fabergé eggs. So if you think of Fabergé eggs from Russia, that's kind of what enameling is. So there's five basic techniques in enameling. One of the ones that I like to do is champlevé. And champlevé is where you etch into the metal and then you put glass inside. And one of my favorite pieces I have right now is a champlevé piece.
Oh, okay.
It's a cicada. So it's based on the brood ex cicadas that we all saw last year and heard last year a lot. My husband and I, when we were still dating, we went the last time they came out to a zoo and they were all over. So that's kind of why I did this. And it's a hinged piece, so it moves and it has some movement to it. And all I did to make this, you just draw on the copper with Sharpie and you put it into a ferric chloride solution and it takes away, it eats away the copper. The same thing you use for circuit boards to clean up the metal in the circuit board. So it's so easy. And so much fun. I actually have my middle school students do this sometimes when we can get the capital together to have that type of material.
So is the Sharpie like a resist, or is that so it eats away where the Sharpie isn't?
Correct. You have to make it in like a negative. So everything that I drew, all the line work in this is in Sharpie. And you can use any kind of dark resist. The Sharpie is just easy to get.
Yeah.
So you can actually even print with a printer, like a copy printer, onto a special paper that you can transfer to the metal. That also works and have more fine results. I had a picture done of myself and my husband back in college that we etched into the metal too. It worked really well. So I love this and I love how easy it is to do. But I also, speaking of glutton for punishment, I think one of my favorite techniques is cloisonné. So cloisonné is where it's like 10 or 12 layers of enamel. So first you put down your enamel to have metal stick, and then everything that's silver on this is metal that was hand-formed by me, and then it's attached. Then you build up the color inside, and then you have to hand-carve and like smooth this down and grind away the glass that's come up over the metal until you have a nice, clean surface with the metal showing through again. So that's this one, and it's very time-consuming, so I don't have as many pieces as I've made like that, but that's my favorite thing to do. But probably the easiest and the fastest thing that I would bring to my shows is just crackle enamel. Crackle enamel, there's no way for me to predict necessarily what's going to happen, so I just put the colors together, and depending on the heat that's applied and where it's applied, it can create different patterns with the enamel. And different colors react in different ways, so like with this set of earrings, you can see if we would zoom in, like the black and the red, there's a much more fine pattern. You can barely see the red through it. This one, with more heat applied, different colors, the cells are much bigger. But if I had the temperature changed even maybe 20, 30 degrees, it'll start to act differently.
So how do you apply the heat?
Well, I actually use a kiln. I have a small kiln in my home that I can use. I know a lot of people who do this work, they do torch-fired enamels. So they would use their torch they use for soldering and use it here. I live in a semi-detached home. I do not have the kind of studio that I would feel comfortable using a torch. My husband
and
probably
thank you
also
for that.
Yes. Same with my neighbors. But I'm hoping to eventually get there, because I've only really been doing enameling on my own for 8 years. And it's been when I have the time to try it out. And most of everything I've done, I had a little taste in school, but everything else I've done has been trial and error on my own. And a lot of my pieces actually are related to insects, believe it or not. Like this piece that I had shown earlier. It is based on a cloud forest cockroach, which you'd never know looking at the pattern. My husband's an entomologist.
Oh, okay.
So we base things on bugs. So I have the cicada, I have this, I have butterfly wings that I do, tiger spill butterfly wings, like the bottom quarter of it. I have another piece that I'm working on, which are peacock spider based. So a lot of nature-based pieces. So you're kind of marrying the softer organic with the harder metal. So that's what I'm really passionate about. I wish I could teach more of it with my students, because they do enjoy it. They love seeing like, oh, I made this and now it's in metal. Like, oh, it's so neat. But we'll get there. Hopefully I can build that up.
Well, and then you said that the metals, you cut that? I mean,
Yep. So I have a coping saw, like a jeweler saw, and this design I drew out, pencil and paper, copied it and attached the piece of paper to the metal, had to cut out by hand all the little pieces, and then you draw the design, etch it, fill it in with the color, grind it down, and it's done.
And when you say grind it down?
You use an alundum stone. to like a knife sharpening stone, essentially. Oh, okay. And you just use that to grind the glass, and you just keep going on a nice even surface, watch TV for a while, you know, get a couple shows that you've been binging done, and then finally the piece is finished. It could take a long time. Mm-hmm. So.
Well, I think our viewing audience and anyone who comes into your booth, you know, is amazed by all the hours of work that go into mm-hmm. these pieces. You know, there's a lot of love in those pieces of
there
jewelry.
There is, yes. Yes, there is. And yes, these are the ones that made it to the end place. I'm still learning. I mean, I'm a bit, definitely, mm-hmm. still a novice. So not every piece that I make ends up being able to go all the way through, because you can't necessarily salvage these pieces once you have everything in there. All the glass on top, but I'm getting there. I'm getting better.
Well, so. And sometimes when you put things in the kiln, like the one of the last pieces you said, you mm-hmm. don't really know what's going to come out, right?
No,
you
know, no. I've done this color variation a lot. This is one of the first ones that I did sell. I do have an Etsy store that I use, too. This color pattern I've sold more than anything else, and every single one looks different.
Uh-huh.
Always looks different. Even if it's on the same blank shape, like it's still... It's mm-hmm. all about the heat that time, the amount of glass that time, because it starts as a powder. You have to sprinkle it over or wet it and pack it in like wet sand. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, it's...
Much like a potter, right? You know, sometimes you never know what you're going to get.
You never know.
When it comes.
You never know.
Well, you know, but, you know.
No, you don't. Yeah, you know it's going to be green if there's copper in it. That's about it.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
You try to control it, but you can't.
Right. It's a surprise. And then teaching someone else to do it, you have to remind them now it's not going to be exactly what you want. You have to be excited for what, you know, the possibilities of what it could be.
A lot of happy accidents.
Yes, yes. Very much so.
But you've set it up so that you're controlled output. So they're,
oh, sure.
They're all... In the neighborhood where you want it to be.
Oh, definitely. I actually have recipes for these, for the crackle pieces, because if you do some experiments and you track, you know, like what temperature each color works at or how it behaves with another color, then it's more predictable, but still not completely. So I have recipes for certain colors, and as I make up new ones, I write them down so I can keep them in a little book.
Do the colors melt at different temperatures?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay, because I know that's how the enamel signs work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's the same with, and it's all within a 50 degree range, normally 50 to 75 degree range. The purples are normally the hottest, the reds not so much, so that's why a lot of times certain color combinations go together better than others. Because if they don't melt at the same temperature, like with the cloisonné pieces, if they don't melt at the same temperature, the wire is very, very finicky, it's very, what's the word I'm thinking of? Temperamental, it's fine silver wire, so it's going to eventually melt. Mm-hmm. So if you're not paying attention, it will melt into your glass, and that's happened to me, definitely. So,
And then what do we have?
Oh, it ends up looking like little beads, or it's just something different. Yeah, it's something different.
You work with it, and
sure. And another thing that I do, I work mostly with copper. You can kind of see that the copper backing on here. There is a little bit of a color on top of it, but to get a silver finish underneath, I use a silver foil, like tooling mm-hmm. foil. And it's still fine sterling silver, and sometimes that lifts. So it's given me an idea for a new series of pieces to do where I'm trying to create like a lifted design in different colors, uh-huh. where you can see it's coming up through the different layers. Mm-hmm. Like there's normally about three layers on here, so seeing the metal itself lifting up, I'm gonna try it out, see what happens.
Yeah, well that's the exciting part about being craftsman mm-hmm. and artist, right? You know, you do something and it may like not turn out, and then you go, you keep getting another idea, and then mm-hmm. voila, it's totally something different and becomes your bestseller.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
You know, and you go, now, just so I can do it again.
Sometimes you walk away from it, and especially with watercolor, I've learned to just leave it alone and come back, because sometimes it flows into another color, and you just don't know where you're going to get.
Mm-hmm.
Mostly in the backgrounds.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I'm sure you've found that, you know, something
you're
like that.
You're frustrated sometimes with some things and just the way wood reacts, because it's a natural product,
mm-hmm.
you know, and just the way it reacts. And you get frustrated and they just throw the piece away and walk away, and then you come back and you grab another piece of wood and start over again.
Or take that and do something else.
Take
with
that
it,
and
right?
try to make you it know? Into something
heat
else.
Heat the back room. I have a big machine. I just put the clay in and regrind it. It makes mm-hmm. new again, mm-hmm. depending on where you are in the process.
I have a farmer that burns wood for heating all his water and everything. He's a dairy farmer. He loves all the scrap I give him.
I'll bet. Yeah,
but we like to do that so that there's no waste, you know.
I mean,
you are like the finest recycler, or, you know, use every bit of everything that you can, you know.
And they love what I take to them then.
I mean,
any kind of paper products, they grind them up and use them for bedding.
Yep.
All my sawdust when I plane wood, that all goes to the farm and they use it for bedding.
Not all of it.
Oh, no.
Goes to Debbie Jarrett.
A handful goes to Debbie.
And gets made into crafts.
Our finest sawdust goes to Debbie Jarrett, you know, and she does the sawdust dolls, and, you know. And
she stuffs her sawdust dolls with my...
Well, not just dolls, but her beautiful artwork, you know. She's, you know.
It's kind of fun with the connections you make with different artists at shows and in the guild, and that's what's kind of fun. It's like, you know, somebody has this, or somebody knows how to do that, or it's just kind of, one of the things I like about being a guild member is that it's a family that will help you, like your square, you step on your square receiver,
hey,
and somebody has a spare, I need a bit here, I left my screwdriver at home.
Yep.
It's very easy and very comfortable. And,
oh, yeah.
You know, you don't worry about, like, going to bring it back.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Right.
I think that's a...
You do become a family. It's just a whole lot of fun. You'll get this, Paula.
Yeah. 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 So we eat a lot of meals together and have camaraderie. And mm-hmm. Yeah.
All of us know who to send somebody to for what they really need.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And the collaborations, though, that have occurred throughout the years, too, you know, I mean, that's another thing, you know, that, you know, that does happen, you know. And we have so many different artists and craftsmen, you know, well, 80 plus, that, you know, that will be at this show. And you will not just meet them, but you become friends with them and you share trade secrets, I mean, you know, as far as how you do things, because everyone is so willing to share, you know what they do.
And one of the things is the guild meeting we have Sunday morning before the show opens.
Yeah.
So everybody grabs, because there's free coffee and donuts first thing in the morning. Everybody grabs a coffee.
For the craftsmen, don't.
Yeah.
For the craftsmen, not for the patrons.
We do have something.
All the craftsmen grab a coffee and a donut and come over and sit in the cafe, and we have our guild meeting. And this year we will have our election of officers at the meeting. So, you know, it's another way to meet a lot of people there, and there's a lot of even retired craftspeople that are in there at that time because they come in for the meeting. They come in to volunteer, because we need people all over the place to volunteer, because it's a big event.
Oh, yeah, and we are grateful for all those retired craftspersons that come back and help us, you know, man the entrance booth, you know, booth sitters. If you're there by yourself, you appreciate that booth sitter who comes in and says, yeah, I'll hang out here for you for a half an hour, go get something to eat and, you know, get to the restroom and stuff. But I was saying, you know, when you said free, we do have special things.
We do have things for the first 50 people on Saturday and Sunday.
Yeah.
I don't know we should say what they are, but they're crafted, made things.
Oh, yeah.
That you would probably like to have. So,
yeah. I'm sure.
And there's a variety, but. Door prize, I guess you would call it.
Slip, yeah. Yeah. You sign a slip when you come in, and then we draw that every hour, and so you have a little extra money, you know, that you can use.
Yeah, it's a certificate to spend at the show
is one of
the things you get.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we work on the show all year long. We'll start in January.
Yep.
And work through. We have a committee of about 10 people, I guess, and everybody has different jobs, and my job is to herd all the cats, and then we get to the show. But it is always amazing that it's like everything gets covered. You know, I'm going to go do this, and you do that, and you do that, and I can help with that. And it's nice. Now, we always need more people in the committee and more volunteers, but it's kind of a fun process to be involved with.
We are just a fun bunch.
So, as you know, Kay is our secretary, so she writes everything down for all our meetings.
I do.
So, for both the general meetings and the the executive meetings and the show meetings.
Show meetings, yes.
So, and then archives them, and we never look at them again.
But I send them all out.
But it is a valuable service and a record of our word, so it's good.
It keeps us on our track, you know, so that we get our things done.
I mean, we have a fairly large corporation in the Guild. I mean, we have a lot to do.
We do have a lot of stuff. You can go to our website, rbcrafts.org, and you can find all our BCTV shows are on there that we've done in the past. All the members of our guild, I think we have about 100 and I think we're
120,
like 100.
120, I believe.
Oh, no, it's more. It's about 140. Yeah, Gary, our membership chairperson just reported that at the last meeting.
And you wrote it down, so
I did.
Good.
So
about 140.
Yeah, it's about 140. So that's a pretty big guild, you know, and stuff. And also, at our show, we will have live entertainment throughout the whole weekend.
Yes, the antique roadshow, the acoustic roadshow is on.
Acoustic roadshow,
which will be good, and it's always good, and.
And we have the Virginville Grange is who
they're doing our food, which is nice to support a local place, and they're very accommodating. So
and they're very good cooks.
Yeah, cooks. E.T. Ouch.
You know,
it's good.
Yeah, you can find us on Facebook.
That helps keep the people around that are shopping by having all that.
They don't have to go out.
They don't have to go out anywhere. You can sit down, have a bite to eat, listen to the music. And go back through the craft show, and a lot of people do that.
Oh, yes.
Go back through the craft show, and then after thinking about it, they buy a few more things after they walk through the second time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. So we have them, that lingering effect, you know. But it's just a beautiful day, you know, and you don't have to worry about rain or anything.
The only thing that was a problem ever at Kutztown with a show was a few years ago we had a snowstorm. Oh. On a Saturday.
Why do you bring this up?
Yes, we did have a snowstorm.
But the university was real good at keeping the snow plowed and all that.
No, and
we moved the show on until the electricity went off.
Yes. But we did return the next day.
Yes.
Okay. And because the electricity came back on and we were able to finish that show that weekend as well. So we just lost a few hours on that Saturday. But. Yeah, so we're not hoping for that at all.
No.
I think the forecast will be good.
Yeah. Anyway, we're hoping.
Yes.
You know, so, yeah, so there's, you know, Saturday, October 29th from 9 to 5, and Sunday, October 30th from 10 to 4.
At the Opaque Fieldhouse in Kutztown.
In Kutztown, yes. You can get it on your maps, you know, it comes up on everything. If you go to it's called South Campus Drive and you put that in there, you know. And
you know, one thing you haven't mentioned yet,
yes,
now there is a fee to get in.
Oh, yes,
but if you have a rack card,
yes,
or you go to our website, you can get $1 off coupon,
yep,
and you know, it all adds up,
yeah. So that is our card. If you want to zoom in on that, yes, there we go. That's wonderful. That's on our website.
I don't think you're holding that up.
No, I know, but it's up there. Yes.
Yeah. That's the card. And those wares are three of our craftsmen. We always try to rotate them on there. These people will be in attendance at the show.
There is, there are just wonderful craftspeople coming. There's something for everyone. I mean, there's so much wood. Pardon? What?
No, we're going to get back to some of these people.
Oh, yeah.
Are we going to talk about Hammerfest, too?
Oh, well, you can say that, please.
Well, yeah.
Let's start with Barry.
The Hammerfest is going to be happening this Saturday at Kutztown, Pennsylvania German Heritage Center.
Cultural
Heritage Center.
11 to 4.
11 to 4. There'll be a few of us there demonstrating and... There'll be a lot of events going on all around the farm, be music going on there. So it's going to be a great event. It's good to have that back happening again. Another event that's coming up that quite a few of our crafters are going to be doing is the traditional show that's done at Nowers at the Alleghenyville Lutheran Church. And that will be October 15th. There'll be quite a few of our craftsmen doing that one also.
Cool. Okay. So Diane, do you have any parting words for your audience here? I'm not putting you on the spot.
Nothing I can think of.
Okay.
I mentioned about the fabric and,
Just
please come to our show.
Because she'll be there.
I think you'll be in booth 7 if I remember correctly.
I will be signing my art the whole weekend and I'll be there.
Right,
I love talking to everybody. So
excellent.
Please come and I look forward to meeting you.
Okay, good. And Bruce, thanks for coming, all the way.
Thank you for including me.
Yes.
And I look forward to returning to the show next month.
Okay.
Hopefully it won't be snowed out.
That was rare.
Were you there that year that happened?
I don't think I was, but I was caught in the storm, so that doesn't usually happen in October.
A while ago, yeah.
Yeah.
The whole area had that snow, and it was a very wet snow, and the leaves were still on the trees, so lots of wires came down with the trees and all that.
So, and Bruce, and then do you sign your, do you have your books there, too? And
yes, I'd be happy to inscribe them. It's their gifts. They make great gifts for Christmas. And I have a new coffee table book coming out. I'll have it at the show. Probably the first time I'll have it is at that show.
Okay, that's great. That's great. And if you go to our website, you can find all of us on that website, and then our
contacts.
Emails are on there, and everything. So you can, look us up, rbcrafts.org. And please don't forget to like us on Facebook.
Okay? Oh, yeah, Facebook's page.
Because
we're on Facebook and Instagram now.
Yeah, we're on Instagram now, too. And they're putting up, all the crafts, the
nice preview.
Yes. So
send pictures.
Yes. All of you, send pictures in so that get them up there for us, okay? And
maybe Paula has a final thought.
Yes, any final thoughts? She's so excited because it's her first show with us.
I know. I am very excited to do my first show. I'm excited to go back to Kutztown, being an alumni person at Kutztown. Come to the show.
Okay.
Please come to the show.
Okay, and if you know any students from Kutztown, that are there now, get a hold of them and tell them to join our student gallery.
I'm working on it. I may have a student from my high school who wants to sell.
Okay. Good. Well, that's really great because, here again, like I said, and we had a little bit of trouble getting the students to come out because I don't want to say the C word, COVID, but over the last couple of years it's been a little rough,
Well, it was easier to get students to come to our shows when we had the spring show at the university.
Mm-hmm.
Because they had more time to get their work done.
Yes.
Yes.
And it's a little harder now.
Yeah.
Paula's definitely shaking her head on it.
Yeah, I think honestly, if getting those contacts out this year may not help for this show, but will help for future shows. We can help build that up a little more. But I know I'm hoping that there's one from my school that I teach at coming. So I'm looking forward to seeing what she comes up with.
Okay. Well, Steve, our fearless leader.
Okay, it's been wonderful. I don't know. So,
Give us
a good show.
Give us your parting words.
Booth 3 is where the pottery's at. No, I expect to see a lot of people out here. I think you'll have a good time. Bring a friend and enjoy the day.
Okay, yes. I'm going to say
it'll be good weather.
Yes, one more time. October 29th from 9 to 5 and Sunday, October 30th from 10 to 4. Come see all of us.
At the Opaque Fieldhouse at Kutztown University in Kutztown, Pennsylvania.
Oh, yeah. You want to be there or be square.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that was from the judges.
Whatever. So it should be a good show.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Thank you for joining us tonight. Next month, I'm going to have several more artists, and they will be here to get you to come on out to this show as well.
I'm looking forward to that, too.
Okay.
So I'll be here, too.
Yes. Yes. Thank you for joining us tonight. Stay well. Good night.
Your Berks Craftsmen on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival and by the Reading-Berks Guild of Craftsmen. BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.